Hello, everybody. Welcome to this very short webinar. It's only 15 minutes long, called How to Add the Wow Factor to Your Apps. My name is Ian Barker, and I'm an Embarcadero Delphi MVP. You can get me on ian.barker@gmail.com, and you can also follow me on Twitter @@punctuation, or get me on the web at about.me/IanBarker. There will be slides and a replay later. Go to tinyurl.com/DelphiWowFactor. It's not up at the moment, but it will be in there in a couple of days. So what is the wow factor? Well, good apps work properly, of course. They're easy to use and they fulfill their users' needs. And that's really the definition of a good app. Does it do what the people want? And do they find it fairly easy to use? Does it make life easier rather than harder than the way that he used to be doing things before? Great apps do all that, and they look good too. And in fact, you know, if an app looks cool or does something interesting, then you'll find that actually people have more faith in your app. They actually believe that your app is better than it actually is, which can be a bit handy if you've got a bug or something like that, because then people are more forgiving. Your app looks beautiful, and as long as it's not full or riddled with bugs, they'll think, well, you know, it's a slip up. Whereas if your app is ugly, even though it performs well, people have this tendency that, oh, it's getting old or it's a bit out of date. And there's this kind of distrust that sneaks in, which is a shame, but unfortunately that is how it works. That's how life works. Now, weirdly enough, the secret wow factor apps that are out there, there's two classes of app that really get the most attention from people like Microsoft and Apple and Google when it comes to their own apps, and that is, the two classes are the calculator apps and the weather apps. And it's a bizarre thing, and it seems to be that the main reason that they do that is they seem to try out different user interface ideas to see how they'll work, and then they put them all together and bundle them all together into the weather apps. Now, weather apps do have a lot of information to convey, and we'll talk about that in a moment while we're focusing on weather apps in particular rather than a calculator. A calculator is more functional. It just, you know, it's got to have some numbers on it and some things like formulas and stuff like that. But really, strictly speaking, there isn't a lot of room for prettiness in a calculator app. You know, you can add some junk to it to make it look pretty and actually make it worse. But with the weather app, you know, it really is effectively a dashboard for information. And that's really one of the things that's happening in this particular set of webinars that this video is for, where we're talking about getting things via the REST interfaces. You can use RadStudio's REST debugger to connect to many of the public API services for weather. Grab that information down. There are lots of them. The US government have got a very comprehensive and very well written, I have to say, web interface that documents all of their API. And so you can get that information down into the app and process it and display it. But even so, it's just weird that weather apps seem to have all these cool little bells and whistles in them. That's a Android app that you see displaying there. But it's the same for the iOS apps. This is the iOS weather.com app, I think it might be. Levon is the place where I live near in Texas. And this is a live version of the app actually working on an iPhone device. Very, very weird. And the oddest thing is that actually they follow that through to the Windows desktop. And I don't know why. You know, do people really want this information? There's much information about the weather. Maybe they do. I mean, weather forecasts are extremely popular. You know, nearly every news broadcast focuses on one, so perhaps there's a lot of demand for it, but it's very odd. And you can see with the Windows 11 weather app here, which is this one that's on the screen at the moment, you can see that it's actually very comprehensive. It's got a lot of things going on. Depth, motion, colour, and you know, modern controls go together to make this app actually have quite a lot of wow factor. It's not everybody's cup of tea. Some people don't like these kind of applications. But as a dashboard, this is a very prolifically comprehensive set of data that's been pulled across there for everything you could ever want. Precipitation, humidity, UV index, all laid out in a way that's actually relatively easy to consume, even those little thermometers there. We're not going to reproduce that particular one because we just don't have time to do that. But we are going to do something similar to that. And that is this app here. So as you can see, on nearly all platforms, the weather and the calculator apps are used to showcase a new design language. And we're going to copy that by doing one of our own apps as well. When you're trying to make your apps look cool, as Delphi programmers, the choice really is, which framework should we use? Should we use a VCL, or should we go in along with the FireMonkey FMX? Now, there are advantages to both platforms, and actually I find myself using the VCL a lot, I have to say. I do a lot of Windows applications, but there are also some very, very cool features of FireMonkey that make it almost irresistible if you want to make your apps look beautiful and really, you know, turn them into eye candy as well as functional. FireMonkey is a very interesting platform to follow. Of course, the big killer feature is that FireMonkey is cross-platform, and it's got lots of cool stuff like animations and effects. It does work differently to the VCL, and that can be a downside if you're used to being a VCL framework kind of person. You've got to relearn some of the things, like text is no longer a caption, it's text. Sometimes that can make it more work for a Windows app. If you've got a Windows app, it's a lot easier in the VCL because it is so close to the metal of the Windows experience that you you find that you're not having to fight against the foibles of FireMonkey. I don't know. I mean, it's a choice. I think, though, if you're going to do a mobile app, which is partly what we're talking about today, then really you need to be looking at the FireMonkey platform. If you're going to use the VCL, you're probably going to need to use some extra libraries to add that extra wow, which we're going to talk about in a moment. Suggested tools. Well, if you've watched me on some of the presentations before, you'll know that I'm a very big fan, and so is Jim McKeith, of Skia for Delphi. It is just the number one thing to actually add to your apps. It will make your FireMonkey apps perform slightly better in terms of rendering. You'll get better quality rendering of certain primitives and stuff like that. It also adds lots of capabilities for graphics and stuff like that. Honestly, if you're using FireMonkey, you really should be putting Skia for Delphi in, even if you don't use any of the controls. We've said it often enough. It's about time you did. Another tool that I suggest, or tool set, and again, I have no links with these particular people. I use their stuff, and in fact, I've bought their stuff in the past for my own apps, but Almedia Dev do some really, really top quality Fluent UI controls. So if you're familiar with the Fluent UI, where you've got this frosted glass effect for the backgrounds of the forms, that things show through opaquely, but they've got this very cool frosted glass effect. You can do it manually, but the Almedia Dev controls, they also render via GDI Plus and DirectX for Delphi and C++ Builder. Definitely recommend looking at them if you haven't before. They're very cost effective, not particularly expensive, and as I said, they do things like GDI Plus rendering, DirectX, and they work for C++ Builder and Delphi. And some free resources as well, and I'm going to show you what some of those resources are in a moment. You can go to svgrepo.com, 300,000 free SVGs, lucide.dev, every kind of icon, everyone you can imagine. Open source, completely free. Download them, use them, off you go. And lottifiles.com, which that site provides the animations which work with Skia for Delphi controls. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to have a look at a couple of things. So first of all, let's have a look at the demo of the app itself. So I'm going to open a project now with Red Studio, and I've got it here. It's called Wow App, just for the sake of it. And in here I have a FireMonkey project. And as you can see, I've got it built for various targets. It works on iOS. I've got it working in the iOS ARM simulator. I have an ARM Mac that I use it for, and it works on there fine. It's easier for me to demonstrate it on a Windows machine just because the way my machines are all connected up. But you just have to take my word for it. Definitely works on all these things. And basically what it is a little short version of the weather app. Doesn't really do much, and in fact it's not even calling the API. But I wanted to show you the techniques behind there for adding the wow factor. Go into here and run the application. And up will come the application in a second. And as you can see, there's that very cool animation. And then the control slide in. Now, I haven't bothered to do the rest of the user interface because this is only a 15-minute slot that we're doing our presentation for here. But you can see that it's got all of the features that you'd want. You saw that when it started up, it got that animation cycling in. And you saw that the cloud logo here, it not only is it animating itself, but also it slid into place. And you can see, hopefully with the resolution, just depends on how that works, that this has got opacity to it. So it's got a nice kind of see-through type opaqueness to it. And all very cool and lovely. So let's have a quick look at what goes on. Well, these are skier controls that I'm using. Skier for Delphi controls. And in here, you can see that these are skier animated images. These ones are turned off, and as is this panel. So if I turn the visibility on for this panel, you can see there's my my little panel there with my information on, which could have been pulled down using the REST debugger and just put some REST controls on here and call the API, the public API that the weather people publish. I've set the opacity of this to 0.5. I start by having it turned off. Now, the reason is that I've actually got an animation control here. And in fact, I've actually got two animation controls. One is visible. And if I just open that up, you can see what animation looks like. In fact, if I make this preview bigger, you can see it even better. So that's the startup animation, and this is a very cool effect. This cost me nothing, this animation. I got this on lottifiles.com. Okay, and that is embedded in this control. And then I have another control with exactly the same animation in it. If I just go back to it, you'll see this is the same animation in a different control, except this control's turned off, and I do not have the animation enabled. And I've set the opacity to 0.2. Now, why have I done that? Well, if I just swap the visibility of these two controls around, turn these on, you'll see that that changing the opacity of that has made this control dimmer. And that means that when I turn the main panel on over the top like this, you get that nice effect. So it looks like the animation has scrolled into place and then has dimmed itself. It hasn't actually done that. What's actually happened is that the animation's been loaded in twice, and I've cheated a little bit. It's just a little trick of the trade to make it look cool. Now, the other thing is the logo at the top, which is here. As you can see, it's this cloud animation. And again, it's a Lottie animation. So if I go into here, you can see what it looks like. Okay. And what I've done is I've actually attached to that a float animation. Okay. Now, this is a pure FireMonkey control. Hopefully, you know how this works. But what this does is it will go and trigger that when that control is made visible, this little cloud thing here, it will change the Y position of this control. So that's where it is, up or down on this form. And it will change it from 800, which is off the screen, until it gets back to 8, which is the top position where it is there already. And it will do that. It'll take 1 second to do that repositioning animation. Very clever piece of FireMonkey stuff that does that. I'm not doing anything at all. There is no code to do that. The only piece of code that I have in the program to do any of those effects is that after the when the very first initial loading animation has finished, I sleep for 1 second, then I turn off the actual animation, the animated sunrise, and then I turn on the temperature panel, and I turn on the cloud view and the dimmed version of the animation control, you know, the one that's got the opacity set to a dimmer value. And I turn off the other control. That's it, really. Okay, well, I hope you found that useful. And we're going to take some questions and answers live, I think. If you're watching this live, if not, then catch up with the blog post, which is listed at the bottom there, tinyurl.com/DelphiWowFactor. Don't forget, it'll be a few days after this presentation before we're ready. I'm very, very busy doing all sorts of other things. Thanks very much. Speak to you soon.